One of the more interesting recent exoplanet discoveries was that of a system of 7 terrestrial planets in orbit around the star Trappist-1. See the dedicated playlist in the end screen for the backstory. Some of these planets, as many as 6, could be within their star's habitable zone, depending on how you define that zone. But as astronomers subsequently studied these newly found worlds, it soon became clear that Trappist-1 might not be an ideal star system for life to form within. This is because of the volatile nature of red dwarf stars early in their lives. They tend to go through a long period of instability before they finally settle down. And they are cool stars, so planets within their habitable zones are located close in and are subject to high levels of ultraviolet light from the star and flares. In short, it was thought these planets did not seem likely to hold onto their atmosphere or any liquid water long enough for life to arise. That is, until now. Entering the debate is the point that the circumstances in which a planet exists is situational, and many factors play into whether it can harbor life. It certainly works that way for Earth, so cookie-cutter definitions of habitability may be too simplistic. In a paper by Quentin Kral and colleagues, a new path for life on some of the Trappist-1 worlds has been proposed. Link to the paper in the description below. The main purpose of the paper was a study of the effects of cometary impacts on the Trappist planets. But from that came an idea that both the UV radiation of the star and cometary impacts together might actually raise the chances of life arising on the outermost members of the system. Part of the problem here is that we do not yet have a clear picture on just how life arose on Earth that we can apply to other worlds we discover. We don't really know the full chain of events that led from abiotic organic chemistry to biology. As a result, it's even more difficult to tell how that would happen on an alien world. Does it always happen the same way? Are there differences? Are there special cases? Were we a special case? All unanswered questions, but one thing that may affect some of the Trappist-1 worlds is how much water they originally had. If they formed far out from their star and migrated inward, it's possible that some of them might have started out with a very large amount of water on their surfaces. Think total water worlds with no land. This could have changed the equation. UV destroys water, but liquid water can also insulate anything living in a deep ocean from UV. So if a planet had enough water to withstand the early days of its star, it could still harbor an ocean, even more so if cometary material was constantly delivering more water to the planet. In such a state of affairs, UV might actually help life, as it can trigger the mutations that drive evolution. And we know from comets in our own solar system that they are rich in organics and volatile chemicals, and might have even been the culprits in delivering the chemical building blocks of life to Earth. If Trappist-1 has similar comets, they might have done the same to some of these planets. Another aspect to all of this is the prediction that the Trappist-1 worlds are probably tidally locked to their star. One side always faces the sun, much like one side of the moon always faces Earth. If so, the night sides of these planets would also provide protection against the star's UV radiation. In such a scenario, if the outermost planets were rich in water to begin with, along with comets delivering more water as the UV helpfully destroyed the oceans, it might make for worlds like Earth, where there is liquid water, but not enough to entirely cover the surface of the planet, a situation that was beneficial for the eventual rise of land-based and ultimately intelligent life on Earth. More, these worlds are close to one another. They seem to perform an orbital dance, where they pass by so close that they would periodically appear larger to their neighbors than our moon appears to us. But this dance seems stable, if complicated. That could mean that if life developed on one of them, it may have been knocked off into space by those very cometary impacts, only to land on other nearby members of the system through panspermia, raising the chances for related life to be present on multiple worlds orbiting Trappist-1. And that leads us to another tantalizing hint of what the system might be like. In another study by Simon Grimm and colleagues, link also below, they were able to further constrain the physical characteristics of the planets through observation, and these very same outermost planets were shown to likely have some sort of surface different from a dead rocky one without an atmosphere. Think oceans, ice, or ice shells with subsurface oceans like Europa. With Trappist-1d seemingly having as much as 5% of its mass in the form of what could be a liquid ocean. And while it's probably tidally locked, it may also have an atmosphere suitable for transferring heat to the dark side of the planet, perhaps enough to make liquid water in the dark possible. All of this makes Trappist-1d the closest Earth analog we've yet seen. though that could always change and probably will. This could be a planet of nightlife, where little life exists on the sun-bathed side of that world, but whole ecosystems exist, perhaps blind ones much like the cave ecosystems here on Earth, where eyes as we know them are of no use. Ecosystems in dark waters or locked under ice shells, unable to see the stars above, and unable to wonder what might be out there. Or maybe not. Further study of these worlds is ongoing, and the prospect of life on the TRAPPIST-1 planets may yet see more shakeups and downturns as more is learned. So, as it stands right now, the pendulum swings back in favor of habitability for the TRAPPIST-1 planets, and if at least one of them has liquid water and is habitable, given that the age of that system ranges from 3 to 8 billion years old, as opposed to our solar system's 4.5 billion years, which was long enough for intelligent life to arise as we clearly show, who knows what any life on the TRAPPIST-1 planets might be like. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier. Be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.